If I can, I'd like to invite your attention to Philippians chapter 2 this morning. If you would, go ahead and stand with me in honor of God's word. Philippians chapter 2, and we'll get right to our text this morning. Look at Philippians, written by the Apostle Paul to a great church at Philippi. These are a group of people who love the Lord very much, who are making a great difference for the kingdom of God. And here, he's encouraging them to do something that is thoroughly Christian. It's something that every Christian should do. As people, sinners, we have a sinful nature that can make us turn inward rather than outward. We can be selfish rather than helpful. And here the Apostle Paul is encouraging this group of people to act in a different measure, a contrary to their nature. Look at me in chapter 2 of verse number 1. The Bible says, If there be therefore any consolation in Christ, if any comfort of love, if any fellowship of the Spirit, if any bowels and mercies, in other words, if you're like the Lord Jesus Christ at all, want to be like him, he says, fulfill ye my joy, that you be like-minded, having the same love, being of one accord, of one mind. And he says, let nothing be done through strife or vainglory. That means looking towards self. But in lowliness, the idea there is humility of mind, let each esteem other better than themselves. He says, look not every man on his own things, but every man also on the things of others. Let's pray. Our Heavenly Father, thank you so much for the Word of God this morning. And Lord, I appreciate this example, this encouragement, this admonition, Lord, to think outside of myself. Lord, you have told me, you have told us as your followers that we are salt and light. And Lord, help us to live each day thinking of that. We'll ask for your help in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you so much. God bless you for standing, and you may be seated. I think all of us would agree this morning together that the Christian life is supposed to be a life of influence. Sadly, many Christians live a life of isolation. With good motive, trying so much to avoid the things of the world, they're really not salt and light as God has called them to be. We are to be influential agents, salt and light. These two key words that the Lord Jesus Christ himself gave us in Matthew chapter 5 describe what we're supposed to be like. We're to illuminate a dark world. We're to be a preservative in a corrupting culture. You and I are supposed to live our lives in such a way we make a difference in the lives of other people. We're to go about doing good. We're to go about being good. We're to show grace and demonstrate mercy. We're to point others to the cross of Christ. We're to do this through word. We're supposed to do this through deed. And you and I are able to do this as we allow the Lord Jesus Christ to find lodging and place in our hearts. You know, we are only salt and light because the Lord Jesus Christ lives within our heart. And in measure that he shines and grows there, so too will our influence. So too will our ability to make a difference in the lives of other people. Again, as human beings, we can be so self-centered, so selfish, so self-absorbed. But when Christ lives in us, and as his influence grows within my own heart, then his influence will be distributed outside my heart through my hands and touch as well. It's incumbent upon us, therefore, to maintain a good and right relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ. I was going to say this morning, if you want to be a person of influence, then you be a person who's close to the Lord Jesus Christ. You should guard your hearts and spend time with God. You should be in a good spiritual place day by day so that as you grow the Lord, other people can see that difference he is making in your life. To the degree that we invite God to influence our lives, you will be a positive influence in this world for the Lord Jesus Christ. And today, there's just a simple kind of influence that I'd like to highlight and talk to you about this morning. It's simply the kind of influence that comes as a result of our taking time to be with and to care for other people. If you read the little bulletin article, that's a great story about a lady who had a neat idea about how to use flowers to brighten and influence other people's lives for good. And that'd be great if you and I could come with neat ideas like that, but really, probably the greatest source of influence that any of us will be today will come from the simple time that we spend with each other day by day. In Sunday school class today, you were with people. And during that time, my friend, you were an influence. This past week, you probably went to work 4 or 5 days out of the past week, and there, you were an influence. Moms and dads, you're an influence with your children. Children, you're an influence with your parents. Young people, you're an influence at school. Listen, every day that we live and breathe, we are some kind of influence on those around us. Our daily interaction with other people is vitally important, and we should think of it as such, not just mundane and not just routine. But listen, what I say today and what I do tomorrow around the people that I'm around every day will help chart the course of their lives. It'll impact them. In some measure, it'll leave an indelible mark on who they are and where they go and what they will become. Though seemingly insignificant, the cumulative effect of our daily words, the time we spent with those around us, does impact and influence them in a great way, either for good or for evil. God does use people to shape and influence other people, and that is certainly true in our daily and weekly interaction with others. One author I read said this: what happens between you and me, or between you and another person, is never inconsequential. It's never just merely a human interaction. For God lives and resides in us and around us. And because God loves people, His desire is to powerfully work in every interpersonal encounter to accomplish good for both parties. That's amazing, isn't it? In other words, you know, if I walk up and talk to the guy today, listen, that's just not a merely mortal interaction. But as a Christian, God lives in me, and the Lord lives in Brother Dai, and He wants this conversation that we have, this interaction, to be good for both of us. If it's me talking to a non-saved person, someone who needs the Lord Jesus Christ, listen, that's just not two people talking. That is salt and light talking to someone who desperately needs to be saved. There is no such thing as just any ordinary interaction when God loves both parties involved. God wants to use every interaction in a dynamic way for good, for encouragement, for help, to point people in a good direction and not a bad one. That is God's hope and intent, that our daily fellowship, our daily interaction, would be things that God can use for good. You see, one of the greatest ways we can positively influence others is just to be with them in a positive way. To say helpful and good and encouraging things, not to tear down, but rather to build up. To speak helpful words and not hurtful words. Just to be with people in a good way. An academic journal entitled The Journal of Happiness Studies. Now that may sound a little bit silly to you, but that's a genuine area of academic research today. It does research to discover what enhances the quality of life for people. What brings people happiness and joy. What is it that cultivates good in the heart of another person? The number one thing that they have found is the happiest people in the world are people who are in a good mental state, people who are involved in good things, not hurtful things, are those with simply this: healthy relationships. Do you know that having more money is no guarantee of being happier? Having a bigger house is absolutely no guarantee of being happier. Getting that next promotion, all the things of the world, listen, those things, and it's not just what God's Word says, which, by the way, He says this, but the academic world says this too, those things do not bring as much happiness as this does. People who have meaningful relationships in their lives. People who are close to other people in positive ways. Social researcher Robert Putman said this: the single most common finding from 50 years of research on life satisfaction is that the happiest, most socially well-being people are those who have healthy social interaction with others. In other words, let me say it this way: one of the greatest gifts you can give to another person is to simply be with them more in a positive, healthy way. To be a friend, to be a positive coworker, to be a happy parent, to be a good child. When we do this, people are helped. But when you and I are absent and withdraw ourselves, we diminish our influence in positive ways, we destroy or at least diminish what is good in them, and we do not help promote what is right. If we want to exert a positive influence, if we want to make a positive difference, if we want to win people to the Lord, then, my friend, it's as simple as this. Look here at me for a second. Be present and be a help. That's not really deep stuff, is it? Well, what is our goal? To be salt and light. What is our goal? To increase our influence. Okay, listen, maybe you're not as creative as to take all these flowers and give them to people at hospitals. That's pretty neat. That's pretty cool. But what you can do to increase your influence is to come to church today and to put a smile on your face to pat someone on the back, to shake a hand, to say an encouraging word, to put a smile and sing with all your heart, you have no idea how that might impact someone for good. You just have no idea. That friendship you have, to actually try to be a positive influence in it, to speak good words to that person, not to be involved in gossip and backbiting and bitterness, to go home and actually be happy to be at home, and not to gripe about your home or the cars or the things that you don't have, but rejoice in the things that you do have so your children see that as a positive, happy, good thing. Listen, increasing your influence is not a difficult thing. It's just becoming a better person in Christ and sharing that with other people. That's how we increase our influence. Today, did you know that there are people who are attending Eastland Baptist Church and have been attending for quite some time, and their greatest desire and need is simply this, is to have a friend? Do you know that? Oh, I don't know what you're talking about. There's 800 people here. Surely everyone has meaningful relationships here. And I say to this, surely not. Surely not. You know, from my vantage point up here, I have a unique perspective. And I'm able to watch some of the social dynamics that go on out here. And I hear this a lot about our church. We're happy, we're friendly, we offer people a warm greeting. But I want you to know there's a difference between that level of meeting people's needs, which is a start, and then going beyond being friendly to actually putting enough of yourself out there to be a friend. I'm persuaded there are people who've been here 3 months, 6 months, and a year who probably aren't really connected the way that some of the rest of us are. And you know, when you're on that side of it, you know, the Bible does say if you'd have friends, to have friends, a man must show himself friendly. All of us have the obligation here, but it is harder when you're on the outside looking in than inside looking out. And you know, just because someone here beside you for 3 months, 6 months, don't assume that they're well connected here yet. Maybe they're just good, faithful people who come here no matter what anyway, just despite it. You see, if you want to increase your influence, become a friend, sit by someone, talk to someone, invite them to your home, be a part of a fellowship, attend the fellowships. It's not this great big spiritual work all the time, although it is quite spiritual. You just need to be a present friend, available in a positive way. There are people today who could benefit from a friend, and they'd be in a healthier, more spiritual place because of a positive influence there. People need to be helped. People need to be included in fellowship. It's been discovered that people without friends who are socially disconnected are between 2 and 5 times more likely to die prematurely. Isn't that interesting? People who don't have a close network of friends, family, are 2 to 5 times more likely to die prematurely than someone else. That tells me this, that people are predisposed and pre-hardwired by God Himself, who, by the way, exists in perpetual fellowship in the Trinity. If we've been made in His likeness and image, you may say, well, I don't need people. And I say to you, you are wrong. Right. And to the degree that you exclude people from your life, you're going to diminish your own. Amen. You're going to hurt yourself. Because that's not how God made you or hardwired you. So we need people. Think about this. Some of you will like this. It's been discovered that people who have poor health habits, overeat, seldom exercise, have high blood pressure, but have a strong network of people they love, often live longer than healthy people without the positive influence of others in their lives. As the old saying goes, it's better to eat M&M with friends than eat broccoli alone. And my wife says, amen, yeah. This is really a terrible story for me to read to you, but I'm going to do it anyway. We see the physical life-giving power of connection in Winston Churchill. He had a wonderful marriage with his wife. He was deeply connected to his family, his friends, his nation, and his work. His health habits, though, were terrible. His diet was awful. He smoked cigars all the time. He drank too much. He had weird sleep habits, was completely sedentary, yet he lived to be nearly 90 years old. Someone asked him, Mr. Churchill, do you ever exercise? And he replied, the only exercise I get is serving as pallbearer to my friends who died while they were exercising. Now, that is not advice from the pulpit. None of that is advice from the pulpit. But it does state an important principle. Is people need people. And listen, people need you. You know, isn't it interesting that all of us are so unique? We're so very unique. We're so different. And you know what? God made you so that you could connect to people that maybe I would never be able to connect to the way that you do. And every one of us are gifted in that way. Every one of you can be a friend to somebody. Every one of you can be an encouragement. Every one of you can just be present in a positive way to be a blessing to other people, thereby fulfilling in some part what God asks of us to be in being salt and light. Because in those healthy relationships, then we can encourage people to serve God. We can encourage people to know God, to find the Lord. It's important that we have these strong networks of people and help other people develop them. There's simple three very quick thoughts this morning about how we can increase our influence in terms of being present with people. Number one, you can increase your influence by simply being with people and meeting their needs. Being with people and meeting their needs. In the text of the book of Philippians, that's really what's in mind here. The Philippian church had needs. People had needs. And yet, even though it was a great church, a good church, a model church for the New Testament, still there were very few people who were willing to extend themselves in a really meaningful way, the way Paul did, for the sake of other people. As you go on and read this book, you'll discover that Paul here commends a man named Timothy. He said, I don't have any man like this guy. He's unique. He stays alone because he cares for you just like I would. He looks around and he sees a need and he meets it. He has his own life issues. He has his own life whatever, but he finds time because he sees it as ministry, not just to people. He understood that even if you do it to the least of these, you did it unto me, said the Lord. So you understand that? When I help you, I'm helping you, but I'm doing it to the Lord as well. It's ministry rendered unto the Lord himself, the Bible says. And there's no greater time for us to do that than when people stand in need. One of the times people need others most is during the times of their greatest need. During these times, you and I can have a great opportunity to influence other people for good and right, and to be closer to the Lord and not farther away from him. If you want to be an influence in a positive way, if you want to make a difference for Christ, if maybe you want to have a chance to lead someone to Christ, then be available during their times of needs. I mean, what would those be? I mean, when people are sick. You know, we have the flu season now that's spreading all through the church and everywhere else. And, you know, just being present, just being a help, taking a meal, just these little acts of kindness. Friend, look here. That's what Christianity's about. Holiness and righteousness, yes. Purity, devotion, yes. But maybe a bowl of soup, too. You know, to visit the widows and the orphans in their affliction is what the Bible says is pure and undefiled religion. People in need. When someone's in the hospital, you know, I wouldn't put Brother Brown on the spot, but my guess is having a network of people who love you and Shannon in these last few months has probably been a huge help. Amen. Probably a big help. And I don't know what the world who doesn't have that does, how they survive it. But it's important. When people are sick and in the hospital, for someone to show up, you know, listen, if you don't have another ministry here in the church and you want one, then you call me, you call the office. And we never have someone who's not at the hospital who probably wouldn't appreciate a visit. You talk about being a help, being present, meeting those needs. When people are hurt, when people are discouraged, you know, when people are disappointed, discouraged, that's a vulnerable time in their lives. That's when either people run away from the Lord or run to him. And the difference between those two choices might just be you. It might just be you. When people are hurt, they generally back up. When people are discouraged, they usually back up. But when you're there to reach out and hold the rope, grab their hand, it might just make a huge difference to them. See, you need no special talents to do that. You don't need any unique giftedness to be a friend of that situation. You just need to be willing. You just need to be able. You just need to be present in those kinds of times. When people are in time to transition, someone moves in. They don't know anyone to help them move into the house. Listen, that's when Christians ought to be present. When people are hurting, they're going through relational issues. When people are lonely, This world is dying from loneliness. And just for someone to be present and positive can make all the difference in the world. Listen, you say, well, I'm not the world's greatest soul winner. I've never led someone to Christ. You start helping people in need, and I bet you'll get your opportunity to do that. You start helping people in need, and I bet leading someone to Christ will be not near as difficult as you think it is. You have the chance to do that. When our presence is real and genuine, we show real concern, when we're available, we will make an influence that might just be immeasurable. There's a common saying in real estate that goes like this: location, location, location. Man, that's the key to success. In like manner, if you want to make a difference in the lives of people, then you need to observe, observe, observe. You don't have to be a real keen observer to find out that people are hurting, they have needs, when people are somewhat, downcast. You don't have to probe, you don't have to pry, but you can say something, you can write a note, you can be some small encouragement. But it's all about just wanting to, paying attention, doing what this text says, looking not every man to his own things. I came to church, I got to go to dinner, I have this appointment. You know what, can I say this to you? Church doesn't have to be all about you and what you get out of it. As a matter of fact, a lot of part of what Christianity is coming to church to minister to other people's needs. And by the way, if you want to get something out of church, then give something while you're at church. You know what? If you're here with just a shopping cart to get, you often may just go home empty. But if you come with a shopping cart full to give, my guess is you'll go back even more full than you came in. That's what Christians do. Someone said, if you can't do great things, then at least do little things with great love. At least do little things for people with great love. And then number two, if you want to increase your influence, use the voice and the words that God gave you for edification and encouragement. If you want to increase your influence today, then simply use your voice, your words, for edification and encouragement. Look here. That's what the Apostle Paul did in this book we're reading. He used pen and voice to be an encouragement to me and you today. 2,000-year-old letters that are still speaking, inspired by God, but written by Paul, to be an encouragement to us today. People need people, and they need to hear positive and good things from people. One of the greatest ways you can possibly be present is maybe not always just even in body, but through a note, or certainly by encouraging word, a call. I can't tell you personally how many times I have been helped, urged on, decided not to quit, committed and inspired to go on, determined to become a better husband, a better father, or a better dad, a better pastor, simply because someone took time to write a note. I don't want to embarrass any of my kids. Actually, I don't mind. You know, notes don't have to be super elaborate. On the back wall of my study, I get these little notes all the time. Things like this. You're the best dad ever. Now that's a stretch, but I'll go ahead and take it as I can get it. I like this one. Dad, you're amazing. I love the imagination of a child. I love you with all my heart. You know, I've received hundreds of these over the years from my kids, and I have every single one of them in a little notebook in my office. And If the world's going to burn down, I'm grabbing the notebook. Because these change the course of a day for me. You know, this one was written by my Abigail, and she has an artistic flair, if you can see the note. And I've never grown tired of reading that same note over and over. I've looked at it hundreds of times. Matter of fact, I have extra of these plastered right in front of my face every single day because they help me. They're an encouragement. It's a connection I have with my children, my wife, that's meaningful to me. It makes a difference. It's a simple way. It's, maybe some would say a small way to make a really big difference in the life of somebody. I mean, when life's rough and you go through a bad bout with other people, you look down at that note there, I love you, Dad, then you make it through. You just go on. It's just a help. I've shared this with you so many times. I have a file lower left-hand side of my desk. Matter of fact, there's two of them. They're overflowing. And it's simply the notes that I've received the last 10 years here as pastor. And they're just an immeasurable treasure. They're just a treasure. You know, some are very short. Some are very long. But in terms of having impact, look here, impact and influence on me personally, there is none greater. There's just not one greater than those kinds of notes. You know, when I was a teenager, I received notes from my youth pastor, and in measure, they shaped my life. As an adult, I received notes from teachers, mentors, pastors, and friends, and in some measure, they've influenced who and what I am. As a pastor, I've received notes. As a pastor, I've written thousands of notes. And listen, if you want to increase your influence, sometimes it's as simple as getting a pen and a piece of paper, taking the time to make a difference and to care enough to give of yourself to try to simply be an encouragement to somebody else. And I want to say something to you. I know there's a tendency in people to do this. Well, I've never gotten a note from anybody. Can I say this to you? And I mean it as kindly as I can say it. We always reap what we sow in life. You know what? Rather than complain about it, why don't be the kind of person who says, you know what? Well, because I'm sensitive to that, maybe I should do it for other people like me who aren't getting them. Does that make sense? Just, you know, it's all about how you filter what comes your way. You can get mad about it and bitter about it. You say, you know what? Because I know what that feels like, I want to make sure somebody else doesn't. And then maybe you'll see how things would change in time for you as well. There's, of course, the words that we speak, literally to each other, is so important. But there is something really neat about a note, a letter, that can change our lives for good. And then number three, and I'll finish this very quickly. If you want to increase your influence, you can simply do this. When you're around people, and do that as often as you can, but when you're around people, try really hard to be happy. You want to increase your influence for good, then do this. I think it's even a song. Just smile and be happy. I don't know if it's a song or not. It just sounds like it ought to be a song. Just smile and be happy. I don't mean contrived, artificial, or phony. I mean, as a Christian, a child of God, knowing I'm on my way to heaven, work to be happy. Look here. The Bible says this. This is the day the Lord hath made. Let us, what? And then what? Be glad in it. Two reasons. Number one, I believe that honors God. This is the day my God hath made. And what right do I have not to honor him back by rejoicing and thanking him for it? But here's the really neat thing about that. When I do that, man, I help other people too. Nothing in this world is more contagious than joy. There are all kinds of genuine academic researches, articles that suggest that happiness affects other people even to 3 points of separation. That means this, that if I'm a happy person and I affect Brother Kevin to be happy, then when he goes to the next person, he might affect them to be happy, which in turn affects the third person to be happy. That's a pretty cool chain of events, isn't it? You know, in negativity, my guess is it has the same influence and impact on people. So how about this? Stop being a grumpy, gloomy Gus. Listen, the world will never stop giving you reason to be sour. The world will never stop giving you reason to be sour. There's something in every day, if you look for it, to be unhappy about. But if you choose to find it, God will conspire to bring things your way to make you happy. If you want to look for those as well. Something about counting your blessings. You know, if you could just come to this place and sing and smile and be friendly and be happy and share joy, you may be given a gift beyond measure. I know we all have different measures of personality that maybe are suited to this, but I'm telling you, simply having the joy of the Lord and then sharing that with people, maybe one of the greatest ways of all to increase your influence. You came to this building today, and there's a truth here. People need people. We're interacting. So let's be positive. Let's be happy. Let's be encouraging. Let's write notes. Let's say kind words. Let's be available. Let's look for need and then actually be part, actually being a part of not just seeing it, but doing something about it. And if we'd all do that today, I believe that our influence would be increased tenfold. Treasures gained in heaven and people helped here on earth, and maybe even souls introduced to the Savior because we increased our influence. Let me ask you to stand today with me if you would. Our dear Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for the Word of God this morning. This simple encouragement, admonition to think outside of ourselves. Lord, to be concerned about the needs, Lord, the hurts of other people. You know, Lord, I pray that you might look upon Eastland Baptist Church, that, Lord, you would be different than you look at the Philippian church. When you said, I have no man like him, Lord, my prayer would be that there'd be all kinds of people here that would share your heart to be a help, to offer simply a cup of cold water to a needy person, an encouraging word, to be a blessing. Lord, help us to recognize that when we are a help, encourage other people, Lord, we're not just doing it to them or for them, but, Lord, to and for you as well. And so, Lord, I pray these next few moments of quiet reflection that people might be more determined, Lord, to simply give of themselves in appropriate ways to the lives and the needs of others. We'll ask for your help in Jesus' name. Amen. All right. Well, just sing a verse or two of Have Thine Own Way, Lord. And if you need to come today for any reason, maybe just determined to find ways to be a help to more people. Lord, I'm coming down. I'm going to write some notes this week. I'm going to commit to do that. Lord, I'm just going to be a happier person at home for my kids and my family. I'm just going to work on increasing my influence by being present. Then if you want to commit to those things, then you come. Maybe you have another spiritual need today. Maybe you don't know Lord Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. You're not for sure that heaven's your home. Then I encourage you to come. We have both men and women at the front here. We'll show you from the Bible how you can know that heaven can be your home, how your sins can be forgiven. Maybe church membership, whatever the need. If you need to come, just the next few seconds, would you come as we sing with Jesse?
Have thine own way, Lord, have thine own way.
Would you come as we sing? Don't tarry long today. And if you'd like to come, I invite you to come as we sing. Just to sing another verse. If you need to come, we have time for you to come this morning. Would you come as we sing? Before dismissed this morning, could I just ask you to bow your heads while the piano plays and just take a few seconds to talk to the Lord about how maybe you can be a greater influence, be more present, available, meet the needs of others, happier in the coming week. Just ask the Lord to help you to increase your influence this week in these simple ways. Father, we thank you that you love us so very much and that, Lord, you're not selfish. Well, Lord, you sought us. Lord, you purchased us. Lord, you sacrificed for us for our good. Lord, as you said, you became poor that we might become rich. And Lord, the servant is not above his master. You've called us to do and be the same. And so, Lord, help us to take the wealth that you've given us and, Lord, to give it time, talent, and treasure. Lord, to invest in the lives of other people in a positive and happy way. We ask for your help with this in Jesus' precious name. Amen. And